So, we are going to present some of the highlights of OpenEMUL 5.4, some of our thoughts for OpenEMUL 5.6, which is going to be the next version. I'm Ruben, and his team are going to give some ideas of the general features of OpenEMUL, and Tino is going to explain in more detail our work in this center. Okay. So when we started OpenEMUL 5.4, our release goals for the last release was kind of stabilizing and simplifying the current features. We worked really hard to level up this center with the KVM features, and we've been working a couple of big enhancements. So OpenEMUL 5.4 is really a big upgrade from 5.2. I'm going to give you just a couple of hints about this new feature, right, in 5.4. And I'm I try to convince you, all of you that are not currently running 5.4 to upgrade, because I think it would be worth it. So the first thing that we've done is improve the high availability and federation of OpenEMUL. We've been in 5.2. We basically rely on the MySQL replication and federation to federate and to implement HCI deployments, right? However, it's not working really good for some of our customers and production deployments, because synchronization between SQLs for long running and some of the deployments didn't work at the end. So we implemented the replication built-in in OpenEMUL, and that replication in terms of or specific for the OpenEMUL semantics allows to deploy or implement the high availability algorithm. OpenEMUL now implementing features and implementation of the Rust high availability algorithm. So basically, when we have several OpenEMUL employees, when right now the state of the OpenEMUL is replicated across several OpenEMUL demos in the same phone. So when one of these OpenEMUL fails, it automatically recovers, and one of the other OpenEMUL is selected as the leader of the zone, right? This replication procedure is also used in the federation. So right now you don't need to depend on MySQL to either have federation or to have HA. Also, you don't need to depend on Red Hat cluster tools like fencing and that kind of things that are really difficult to deploy and maintain in production. So this is easier and I think more reliable to deploy, right? This is one of the big changes in 5.4. Other feature that we received a lot of requests in the past was the need to easily specify and express the affinity or anti-affinity of PMs. So basically we developed the concept of PM groups. A PM group is expressed which PMs are related and how do you want to deploy those PMs. So for example, you have a multi-tier service with different multi-VMs. So you define roles like the service. You have your backup role, your DB role, your monitor, your frontend, and you can specify things like, I want all the VMs in the backup not to be in the same hypervisor and not to be deployed in host 5 and 6, for example. So you can tune the deployment of the virtual machines so you don't defeat the purpose of them. For example, you want all the backup VMs to be in the same hypervisor, because if it fails, you're going to lose all your backups. The same thing for example, for performance, some VMs, your database VMs has to be deployed in the same host, and you want or wants to use some of the high performance hypervisors in your cloud, so you can specify that. The way you use that is that when you deploy a VM, you say, this, I want this VM to be deployed in the group in the group for my service. I want to be this VM in role backup. So the scheduler will automatically define scheduling requirements to allocate or deploy the VM, so it's a pin or put together with the VMs in the role you want, right? It was also a very big new feature, and we made a couple of more enhancements that I don't have for too much time to discuss with you, but just to highlight that we have improved the IPv6 management in OpenNebula. Now you can define known Slack addresses. Security groups now works for IPv6. You have more fine grain to define action controls, because you not only can define which users can use which VMs, but you can also define which actions are allowed to be used in each write each permission. Like for example, you can say, I don't want my users to suspend a VM. So you can move that action out of the use permission and put it in the admin permission, for example. We have minor enhancement in the storage, like live resize of this. That was also a long feature requested. Some tools to do housekeeping of your database, like purging history records, updating XML documents without stopping OpenNebula and doing the hacks in the database. And we also work in Sandstorm to work some of the dialogues and make them more user-friendly. And finally, for 5.6, we don't really want to make very big changes in OpenNebula, but rather improve or make some improvements for the quality of life. So right now we have VM groups. We want to work on merging one OpenNebula flow on VM groups. Also the ability for users to create VM networks, because we right now we have the reservation of other ranges, but we want to extend that and make it easier, better virtual interface, and minor things to as I said, to improve the quality of life of cloud admins. So basically, this is our ideas for 5.6.
Thanks, Owen. So, well, hello everyone. Before I continue, let me ask you, who's using currently OpenNebula to manage VMware-based infrastructure? Okay. Okay, so this is for you. Okay, so, well, I'm going to talk a bit about the main improvements in 5.4. Basically, managing VMware infrastructures, we always talk about the vCenter driver, because all the interaction of OpenNebula with the hypervisors is done through the vCenter API. So in 5.4, we did a couple of big advancements in the model of management for VMware. So for instance, in storage, in previous versions, we followed a delegation approach. That means that all the storage management, or most of the storage management, was delegated to vCenter. So when you clone a VM template, vCenter will be in charge of cloning all the disks. And also, most of the disks in the VMs and VM templates were non-existing for OpenNebula. So OpenNebula didn't see them. So we're lacking a lot of functionality that OpenNebula offers in other hypervisors, like for instance, disk quotas, or basically the ability to resize a disk or to or to detach it. Those things weren't present previously. In Medusa, what we did is we enhanced the model. So now OpenNebula allows you to have a complete view of all the storage of the VMs. Okay, so this allows OpenNebula to do pretty cool things, like for instance to use the scheduler to do storage balance between different data stores, and achieving this without the Enterprise Plus license, which is kind of costly. And this process is kickstarted by importing different resources, like for instance, when you import a VM template, OpenNebula will create query vCenter to ask for the specific disks that this VM template has, and let the user know about the size, for instance. And this will happen as well for wild VMs. So wild VMs are VMs that are running in vCenter, but that hasn't been launched by OpenNebula. So some functionality that this allows is the ability to do this precise, also the ability to use linked clones. So this is kind of a cookout tool like functionality, where only the changes in the disks are written, but not a full copy of the disk is needed for different VMs. You can also save the VM disks for later use in another VM template or another VMs. Also, you have the ability to create non-persistent images, so OpenNebula will make the copy of these images for you. You can create volatile disks, so these are disks that are created for a particular VM and then destroyed after the life cycle of the VM. And finally, the ability to create disk quotas. This is very interesting. With a tool like OpenNebula that offers provisioning of the infrastructure, the ability to have your users to put limits on how they can spend their resources. Okay, so a similar advancement was made in network management. So in previous versions, OpenNebula followed a consumption approach for networking. So you cannot create new networks. You can only use existing networks. And also the existing network interfaces of VMs and VM templates were also opaque to OpenNebula, so OpenNebula didn't know about them. Okay, so in Medusa, you are able to create these networks. You are able to create standard networks and also distributed port groups and distributed virtual switches. And this is also included in the automatic import of VM templates and wall VMs. Okay, this allows for instance, things like automatic VLAN provisioning, so you can create a multi-tenancy environment straight from OpenNebula without having to define these networks manually in vCenter like in previous versions. You also can limit the usage of the network by your users by imposing quotas. You can create, finally, a multi-tenancy environment, as I said, directly from OpenNebula, and also you can use stuff like virtual routers to connect different isolated networks. Some other enhancements, maybe not as big, but also important, is performance enhancements. So the drivers were completely reworked. So now all the operations are cached, or most of them are cached. So that allowed for a significant speed up, especially of the monitoring times, also the memory consumption of the monitoring probes were quite kind of a pain in previous versions. Some other nice things that OpenNebula added in 5.4 is the ability to distribute the resources in different folders, for instance, the ability to save existing virtual machines as templates, so they end up as a template both in vCenter and also in OpenNebula. Also the automatic management of VMs imports, which were also a kind of a pain in previous versions. And things like monitoring metrics that before were possible because OpenNebula didn't know about either disks or networks. Okay, and everything it's packed in OpenNebula clusters. So whenever you import a resource in OpenNebula from vCenter, they all end up in their own OpenNebula cluster. So things like networks, data stores, obviously vCenter clusters, they are packed in this concept that OpenNebula has, and this allows things like having, I don't know, different networks in different even vCenter instances with the same name, which is something that is surprisingly common. Okay, and just to end, I want to introduce you to V1 Cloud in case you don't know it. So V1 Cloud is an open nebula distribution that is tailored for VMware-based infrastructures exclusively. So you don't have here KVM support or the hybrid connectors to Amazon or Azure. But on the other hand, you have an open nebula that is really easy to install. So it's basically an OVA file that you plug into your vCenter. And thanks to the import capabilities of Open Nebula over VMware, you can start creating your cloud in 5 minutes. Not joking. You can start importing resources, creating groups of users, assigning them their resources, and it works straight away. This is obviously for small to medium scale infrastructures. If you need a large environment and also advanced features like federation or high availability, this is not. This is not your product, but for SMEs, it's a nice way even to get to know Open Nebula because you can install it and upgrade it really easily. Also, it's zero intrusive, so you try it out, you don't like it, just shut it down, and all your VMs will be still there and working. Okay, so that was it for vCenter. So, do you have any questions for me or for Ruben? It will stay in pending forever.
Okay.
Yeah.
So as soon as
you can provision another host, or I think you can even change the VM group rules to relax them.
For example, you can also implement like a soft constraint, like, I mean, soft affinity rule or not affinity rule. Soft, if I can define that with respect, I'm not getting it. It's a soft constraint. Soft, just relax.
It's kind of soft because if you, for example, you want all your VMs in the same host, you can deploy the VM manually in other host. This host or this VM becomes a pin to deal. You can use that one to deploy other VMs. So although you require that all VMs are together, you put another VM in another host, that is going to be used. So in that sense, it's not it's a soft affinity because you can bypass the requirement altogether. For example, manually migrating the VM to another host, and that's going to be considered. So you can bypass the error pass.
So a related question to that, like the affinity, is this code? So for example, if you say like host is 2, 3, 4, would it look for 2 and then for 3 and then for 4?
Yeah. Any of them is going to be bad.
Yeah, they are all valid, but like they are checked in sequence.
Yes. Yes, and they are sorted according to rank, because you can associate to each host the rank. So you check it in sequence, but they are short if you associate it, for example, this first those with less DMs running in the host.
Which is the snapshot thing and all the reset, the snapshot thing that support in this new version of the reset?
It's the snapshot we have. I think that in the previous versions, they were not working when you do the system snapshots, and now they are.
And now they are out of manual, so that there is a button to launch the snapshot.
Not really sure. Not really sure. I have to check.
So, how to do a
So the goal would be not to use those.
So anti affinity, but not in another host. I want it in another chassis.
Yes, you can use clusters. So you can, in the same way you say, I want these VMs on these hosts, you can use clusters.
Okay.
I want all these VMs in this cluster or not in this cluster. So if the hosts are grouped in a cluster, I can do that.
But you
have to have the cluster grouping on the hosts.
And in that case, you don't specify anti-affinity on the cluster level. You just say these VMs on this cluster, these VMs on that cluster.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much.